welcome to the DDE show, episode 3.
Tres.
This week we're going to talk about mainly music. We're going to talk about some songs that we've got played on the radio. We're going to discuss some promoters indirectly. And then we're going to talk about some influences that these guys have had throughout their careers. So let's kick it off with the having your song played on the radio. What's that like? Like the first time you hear it, like, what's going through your head?
It was freaking crazy. Like, I really enjoyed listening to myself on the radio, but I really enjoyed the people that was calling up and requesting a song. You know what I'm saying? Because now they got us in regular rotation. You know, we plan at least twice a day, which is good enough for me. I never had that before.
Any spin is a good spin.
Yeah, any spin is really a good spin. But the people that's been calling and requesting it, and for a while people was calling and requesting it and they weren't playing it. Because I was at work and they was calling, you know what I'm saying, from the job. Like, mm-hmm. I want to hear it, you know, because we play the radio. You know? Nobody ever, they never fucking played it. They just said, yeah, we'll play it. 1 second, right after Katy Perry. And they never fucking played it, but now they got us in regular rotation. That's
big though. You know?
It's kind of dope, bro. Like that, that's history in the making.
Well,
that's
and you can tell too. You can tell when that shit happened because that very next show after we started getting in regular rotation, like they did the Oh So Far Away, and the crowd, like they were singing it to us.
Yeah.
And that shit was crazy because we had no idea how big that song actually was.
Yeah, we did. They said in order for them to play, they had to be super, like, squeaky clean, you know? And we did a squeaky clean mix to it, and we gave it to them, and we never thought no more about it. We even stopped performing it. Mm-hmm. But after we saw that they was playing it more and more, we performed it, and everybody in town pretty much knew it.
And so y'all know that I'm here. You know, my song got played and shit on the radio.
Yeah, Big Mike not on that song, though.
I'm not on that song, but I was...
Yeah,
I had something to do with the song, like when we perform it, I'd be all over
that. Yeah, you be singing the bridge?
I'd be all over that.
Big Mike is the one on stage that's light out.
True. My light flames up. Yeah. But it's a dope song, though.
Yeah.
That was a big deal for me, too.
That was a huge...
That was a big deal because...
And it's real shit. I actually woke up, like, mad early to catch that radio.
And so listen, not only did he play it, he interviewed me first. You know
yeah, that's what I'm saying. I missed the interview, but I caught some of the songs.
I was actually working when that happened. I took a whole...
Charles City?
I was like 12 minutes, whatever it was. I took that out of my day and just sat in my truck and listened to that. Because that, for people who don't know, Charles City, they didn't embrace rap and hip-hop at all. Mm-hmm. Like, they wanted to do whatever they could to keep that shit shut down. They didn't want it. They didn't want that. So when we heard that song on the radio, for me, that was probably bigger than anybody because I knew, like, how hard it was. And he would know, too, because he had to fight just to get shows in town. He went to every place, and we could only get one spot in town to even let us do that.
And to this day, we still rock at that same one venue, even though we've had offers to do other venues. I'm like, no, if we in town, we're going to do it with the person that rode with us from the beginning.
And right? We will continue to do that until they, you know... Until nobody wants to hear that in District 1, that's gonna be a long fucking time.
True. It probably ain't gonna be never, because I'm gonna make you like my shit.
Well, shit. You know what? And not to mention, we got the next generation. His kid is already starting to write.
Your son beatboxing.
My son's beatboxing.
my son's an asshole.
Hey, my son's an asshole too, but he'll beatbox the shit out. He did that at a football game, right? That's the first time you heard it.
First time I heard it, so I was like,
my son started.
They started a cypher. Like, they was getting it in.
Like, oh. My son is 8, by the way.
And this son, how old is your son?
8. Lil J Fox.
My sons is teenagers. They just assholes.
Hey, the Bob King of Charles City. 19-year-old, right?
Yeah, Junior just paid rent, man. Something. That's how old he is. He was paying rent. He helped out on the rent.
All right, now you're working on something new for the radio. Something extra clean and very mainstreamish, if you will.
I mean, it's still me though.
Right.
Yeah, I don't consider that shit mainstream.
No, that shit is not.
You know what? I won't say.
Maybe it's on edge. It's just clean. Right. You know what I mean? Ain't no cursing. But ain't no ninjas.
It's
in
also
there.
No. But it's also got a hook that people will gravitate towards.
Yeah. Well, we can go ahead and release the name of the song. The name of the song is Never Win, and it's about people coming together, and you know what I'm saying, people coming together and establishing what they believe in. You know what I'm saying? And it's not about black, white, Mexican, or none of that. It's about as one people, like human, pretty much. You know what I'm saying? The song, I dig the song. It was a bit of a struggle because I really couldn't talk to my core audience the way I usually talk to them. But the song turned out pretty dope. But it's not even done yet.
Yeah. Well,
be on the lookout for that. Yeah. Never Win.
They started recording that tonight, and it's crazy, but with that being said, we got a special treat for y'all tonight. We're going to show you the Oh So Far Away video, which is on spin at our local radio station.
Yeah, and I'm not in the video. Don't worry about it, though. It's still a good video.
Right. Video is awesome, so go ahead and check that out, and then we'll be right back.
Directed by Cheddar Chad.
True.
Just want to take off and go somewhere, you know what I mean? Like, I really don't have a destination. I wish I can fly.
I wish that I can spread my wings and fly. Oh, so far away.
Like it's us when it's not. My city get rough when it's hot. And every other block, somebody getting popped. Kids forced to watch you, almost forced to tow the clock. The things we use to calm our nerves got a special tax. $8 squares and $40 yaks. So now we at your back doors waiting to attack. For a little bit of scratch, either that or we moving packs. Just to how to find the things in life. Or to feed our families at the end of nights. They give us jobs to keep us even with the cost of living. This man robbed so he can eat, I hope God forgive him. You go to college, graduate, and still no jobs there. Rich man's greatest quote, life ain't fair. You win some, you lose some, I guess. But when you lose them all, you make your next move the best. Fly.
Mountain, stand upon the rock and look down on the world.
man don't want to be given anything. A real man want to earn what he feels is his. So if you're not putting us in a position to earn what we're supposed to have, we're going to take what we want. Bottom line.
Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the video. Now we're going to discuss something that I have a lot of experience with, because if y'all don't know, outside of this, I also manage the group and I set up shows and do all that. I want to talk about promoters. Now, we're not calling anybody out on this, so if you think that this segment is about you, maybe you should change the way you do business.
Or quit.
Or quit. Yeah, just stop doing it all together, because I've dealt with some pretty shady motherfuckers out there, and it's just not easy, and y'all make yourself look stupid. So, let's talk about that. Cloud, like, you started fucking with these promoters before I really jumped in there and did that, and let me, when you're looking for a promoter, like, let's say you want to go out on tour, what are you looking for in a guy to like promote a tour or a spot or whatnot?
Well, just looking at what they've done previously, you know what I mean? I go through and I see what, you know, it's pretty much their resume. You know what I'm saying? I don't just go pick a guy like, yo, he just started promoting yesterday type shit. Unless I know the guy, then I help him out and, you know, go fuck with him like that. But I don't know, but even when you research a fucking promoter, you still can be wrong. You know, and I've done that.
You good?
No, I'm good.
You sure?
That's had a little burp, man.
And you fucking up my shit, because I was like, oh my speaking God, proper and
about
shit.
You.
But,
yeah, this proper shit, that ain't even you, bro. Like, talk like,
bro, this is me. I'm the CEO of a company.
Yeah, and I'm a CEO. Oh,
this is how I'm supposed to talk.
I'm just losing it.
Right? So promoters, some promoters know what they're doing. Other promoters just probably need to just, you know, go back to Wendy's or whatever and work there. But you know what I found to be the best promoters? Promoters that are artists and promoters at the same time. Those be the best promoters, because they know, like, it's hard to have a promoter that's never rocked the stage before. You dig what I'm saying? So, and it's a struggle.
Well, I agree with that. I'm going to give a for instance right now. I'm not going to name any names, but a spot we did in Kansas City. That was probably the best show we've done to date.
Shout out Michael Hammer. We ain't calling nobody out, yeah, though.
Yeah, we're not calling him out, but that show was professional. Mm-hmm. It was ran on time.
Mm-hmm. That shit was busy.
And there was people.
That shit was crazy. Listen, after the show, we done, because I didn't have my ID, so they basically kicked me the fuck out right after I get done. However, we go out the back door because we performed outside. That was the first time I performed outside, you know what I mean? We go outside, it's police cars there, it's hundreds of motherfuckers everywhere. I thought somebody got shot.
With his background, you would understand why.
Exactly. So you know what I mean? I'm looking like, yo, like, I don't think we should be in this fucking vicinity. But this is what they do on Fridays and Saturdays, bro. Like, for like, what? I think it.
They said for everything. They block it
from
off.
From that whole strip, bro. Like, it was like 4 or 5 blocks up. They had shit.
They block off all the blocked downtown. Off.
Exactly. And you party. That shit was massive. It wasn't no women there. I don't. I never looked at a fucking soft leg there, because I didn't see him, because, you know, I'm so fucking blinded just by doing my job and shit. I just go hard, man.
Get the fuck out of here.
Reason why I say this shit, because it's like everything I fucking do,
certain shit I say get pinpointed in these shows.
Oh, so you saying the bitch? It was bitches there.
So it was not one. Let me.
You trying to say one? The bitch
it was
there.
Not one bitch in Kansas City.
So, but guess what? I can say that shit just by certain motherfuckers watching this show. Certain motherfuckers. I'm not gonna say no name. Certain motherfuckers was getting heat from being at the show. Like at the show. Like you know. Like yo. Like we at a fucking venue. It's gonna be fucking brides there. It's gonna be dudes there. And motherfuckers was getting heat there. Like, oh, really? You didn't see that half naked bitch right there.
What? Baby, no, I didn't see that happening.
I didn't see that bitch.
I'm watching the performance.
With amazing ass right there. I didn't see her. I never looked.
Listen, that shit was fucking crazy. It is like the Taste of Chicago, you know, like in 90. No, fuck that. The Freaknik back in 94.
Oh, yeah.
In Chicago 94.
Was that Maywood? I couldn't even go.
But it was crazy.
I remember though.
I know people get shot out there too, but nobody got shot when we was in over there. So I feel like moving there a little bit.
I wanna move everywhere I perform at.
But Kansas City, dope.
But what about the show? How was the show?
The show was crazy.
It was put together.
It was an inside bar and an outside bar, and it was a show in the inside, and it was a show outside, and the shit was all going on together. Headliners.
And we weren't performing for rappers.
No. Exactly. It was rappers there. It was a lot of motherfuckers there, and this dude, he fucked with them. He fucked with artists. I'm not going to just call them all everybody rappers. No, he was fucking with artists. Like, they had a wall of list of names. I ain't going to plug them because, you know, I'm not going to get half of that paper. But
no doubt.
Yeah, they get busy in Kansas City. Don't sleep on that shit. There ain't nothing like fucking the Wizard of Oz out there, yo.
That place was packed that
straight
night.
Straight up.
The crowd was extra crazy. Live.
Crazy.
They dug everything we did. Actually, if you watch the Wild Out video, there's a little bit of footage from that spot in there. So.
But can I plug one thing? Y'all motherfucking beers in Kansas City at that fucking bar. I will give you the bar a shout out too because y'all did show us love too. But like I said,
the beer's too expensive.
Come on, big. $5 cups like this, really, a beer.
They're not even that big. What the fuck you talking about?
They wasn't even that big. No, they was a club joint. They were small. And I don't even drink
They're
beer.
They're like the ones you get shots out of.
And I was looking at motherfuckers drinking beer like, he's balling. He could buy a $5 shot of beer.
Hey, we drank a couple of them. They were good.
They were good. Good.
They were good beers. Hey, but
I left all my alcohol in the car. I had like a shot. No, I had two shots of Hennessy. And if you get the cups, it was some kind of special. If you get the cups, you get, what was it? It's two for something. I know I ended up getting two.
This motherfucker bought me a drink.
I bought him a drink. That's how fucked up.
When I was on like a double.
He couldn't go to the bar.
Double or triple or some shit?
I don't know.
Because that was a big shot.
Oh,
bro.
Yeah, it was like a double or triple. It was a double gin.
Yeah, because that's why I'm still on my smooth shit. I just might use the orange juice on my diabetic. But I drink my gin. But and that shit was, the double shot, triple shot was cheaper than the beer.
Listen, you know I'm having a good fucking time when I buy somebody a drink.
Definitely a dude.
I don't think I'm going to do the drink. Yeah, but you like my squad, though, bro.
Unless it's my people, my fans.
Can't nobody even knock me for that.
No, that's what I'm saying.
But the only time I reach is when I'm having a good time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's get back on track. Let's talk about the promoters.
You get back into it, sir.
Okay.
Please. What do you think about promoters?
Actually,
I'm practicing
this interview here.
I'm practicing to be the host.
I don't like all the pressure.
Yeah, I'm gonna cry.
But no, seriously, Michael Hammer, you had your shit together. But with that said, like, he knew his strong points. He stayed in Kansas City. Right, he's from Kansas City. He stayed in Kansas City.
True.
We're fucking with promoters that are from a certain spot, and they're trying to promote shows fucking 600, 700 miles away. And not going to that spot.
And don't even fucking do no groundwork.
You need to calm down.
Like, yo, you got to do groundwork. You can't still be in the spot where you was born and raised at and then think you're supposed to be collecting chips over there. Like, that ain't going to work with me.
With promoters, it's not just booking the show. You have to promote the show. And Facebook is fucking that shit up because you think, oh, I'm going to make an event. This is promotion. Nah, fuck that. We're tired of performing for the same rappers in the same town every time we go.
Listen to this. When we promote our shows, how many times have we created an event on
Facebook? Never. We did it one time, and that was for Lil Flip.
Right.
And that's,
but after that, it was like, yo, we having a show. We out there on the ground.
We putting up pluggers.
Groundwork.
Like, you know, people to people. That's
see a motherfucker out and about, like, yo, you going to fly in. Look, come and check that out.
Right. Catch a motherfucker at the grocery
groundwork.
Store.
You got the internet work. Now. The internet now, bro. Like,
the internet making motherfuckers lazy.
Lazy.
But you can tell. You can tell they're lazy by the turnout of the shows.
True.
You know what I'm saying? We get to, we travel 700 miles to a venue. We travel 700 miles to an empty fucking venue. That shit whack.
And performing for rappers that we already know. Like, they already know.
We did a show one time, and it was 15 people there. Seven of them were rappers, and all seven of them was in the same group, so we got one contact. Out of all the motherfuckers, man.
I don't knock it. Because this is the grand. Ooh. This is the grand, you know what I mean? Ain't shit gonna get handed to nobody. So I rap with that, you know what I mean? Like, I'm comfortable with that. Because our motto is what? 300 or 300. Mm-hmm. It don't matter if it's 3 motherfuckers or it's 300. If we gonna go and do a joint, we gonna do what we do.
Yeah.
We gonna force it down your throat, bro. Like,
and you gonna like yeah, one song.
You gonna like somebody. Something gonna hit you like, yo, I fucked with that. I don't like none of that though, but I like that one.
Yeah.
And that's all we look for, man. And we groundwork, bro. Like, shit, how many joints we'd have been on when we was doing joints out of town and motherfuckers was like, yo, y'all gotta sell tickets out of town.
You know, motherfucker, we don't even live there. How the fuck we gonna sell
tickets? We ain't know nobody there.
Yeah.
So you promoters need to get off y'all fucking ass, man, and start doing groundwork. Go and sit up in the city that you trying to promote a show at, and go and sit up there for fucking 2 weeks. Right. Y'all part-time promoters because y'all got a 9-to-5, really. Motherfuckers know they working on Grizzlies, and I don't knock you doing that either. You got to get your paper. But still, don't be sitting up there trying to put that much pressure on the artist and then sit back like, yep. No, fuck that.
Like, you put all the pressure on the artist and then you sit back and
Now I'm in my duffel bag. Fuck what y'all talking about.
Let's go.
Because anytime a motherfucker, like, you know what I mean? Like, you come to our fucking towns, or you go to anybody's town, and you know that they getting it popping there. You getting a little paper, that's fine. It's business, I understand. Business is business. But you ain't gonna sit up here and fucking sit up here and try to charge or tax the motherfuckers that you've been getting paper with when we go into another town.
Right.
That shit rubbed me clean the wrong way.
Here's what rubs
me. I got my mama. My mother had to pay a fucking ticket to see her son perform first time in her whole life, you know? Like. And then, when we perform, we at the venue, it's number rappers there.
That show was the 15 people.
You did see what I'm saying?
So five of them was your people.
So you think that shit didn't rub me?
Five of them was your people. Seven of them was rappers that was in the same group. You know what I'm saying?
And then, you know what? Not only that, but then you have the gall to sit there and talk about how our show didn't perform as well as you would like. Okay?
With every show we did with you,
Diamond District brings 150 people.
Didn't bring nobody was getting cuts, no parts of this shit. You feel me? We doing it in front of rappers. Motherfuckers come to our spot. We got heads there. I don't give a fuck if it's 30. It could be 30 motherfuckers one night. That's 30 motherfuckers that we done went and did a show with a motherfucker. It was only rappers. So you kiss my ass with that. And I don't give a fuck what nobody talking about. Cause, like, I say your name, but that's not what the show about. Because I ain't worried about a motherfucker doing nothing to me.
I don't give a fuck about that.
No, see, that's why I ain't want to talk about this. Because I know I was going to be mad about it.
You mad right now?
Bro, this shit rubbed me.
Get your drink.
I'll tell you, thank you.
All we're going to say about this is, don't tell us that our show is not performing. And then we go to your next weekend, do a Friday, Saturday show, and we got 30 people combined. When we're bringing 150 plus in that show and making you money. Mm. So don't call us out like that, because you can ask anybody we fuck with. Rucka Puff and Absent. You guys can vouch for this shit. We've made you guys money in this town. So
it's probably not a fucking 15,000.
Yeah, we're not building a house out of this shit.
But you gotta understand, my town is this big. This is my fucking town too. Like, I'm a fucking Charles City native. Fuck what y'all talking about. You know what I mean? I've been here over 10 years.
Fuck y'all talking about. This is my fucking town. This
so you knocking the people that ain't been here?
No, I'm not knocking the ones that ain't been here, but you ain't gonna sit up here and... Fuck it. Yeah, I'm knocking the ones that ain't been here for 10 years. So
I've been here 4 years.
So, motherfucker, and you so comfortable here. You comfortable here. So, motherfucker, what we haven't done for this town, too?
Yeah, that's true.
Hey.
Yeah,
everything. Look at our kids. Let's get to something else.
Our kids.
That's next show.
Our kids about to dominate the fucking leagues.
It's not even that. Just kids, our kids. It's not just our kids. It's their friends. It's everybody. This is a whole different lifestyle that's growing up in this small town. I love this town, man. This is my town. I'm Chicago bound, not Chirac. I'm from Chicago, Windy City, / Charles City, Iowa. I still got love for Buffalo, New York, because I live there too.
Here's the last thing I'm going to say about this. We live in a town of 7,800 people. We bring 150 people into our bar for a show. We go to a place that has, I don't know, 10 times that many people. You can only bring 10 people. You're not doing your groundwork. So,
Big up to all the artists out of Charles City that started, because we gave you niggas to push too. Don't get it fucked up or twist. We push you niggas too, because y'all seen us getting that love, and that drove y'all to fucking do this shit too. But still, big up to every artist is doing their thing.
Alright, now.
Weak ass promoters.
Fuck y'all.
Hey, y'all touching the wrong way.
Straight up, man. I'm in my duffel bag. Fuck y'all.
Alright. So now, we're gonna move on.
Get to some light shit so I can start smacking.
Try to get Mike calmed down a little bit, because right now, he's turning white. You probably see him in the camera a little bit better, huh?
This is uncut, though. This is real shit, y'all. This is what you gonna get.
This is what the DDE show is about.
I don't bite my tongue for nothing.
No, fuck that. Alright, now we're gonna talk about.
I gotta be saying motherfucking name.
Yeah.
I did motherfucking the challenge, man.
What are you gonna do? Beat you up?
Alright.
So you gonna have to pack a lunch?
Alright, we need to move on because we got one more topic that I wanna talk about. And that's, like, who influenced y'all when you were coming up? Like, when you started rapping, who was, like, your main influence?
Well, my favorite rapper of all times, y'all already know this, is Biggie. It's the N-O-T-O. All right. And that's my mainstream influence. My underground influence was this dude named E-Dub the Gangster. That was like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was the first dude that I heard spit.
Shit on Facebook not too long ago with E-Dub the Gangster.
Bro, his name is like E-Dub on Facebook. I don't know. It's Folks Nim.
E-Dub, Folks Nim. I think that on your shit.
Hey, listen. I was rapping a long time ago, bro, but I was like 17. I was working at Super Kmart, and they had this thug ass nigga doing loss prevention, bro. Real shit. Like, mistake. Biggest mistake ever. But anywho, I ain't gonna air his dirty shit. But I played him with one of my joints when I was 17, and he like maybe 2 years older than me. He had to be way older than that. He probably like, he was 21 when I was 17. He played me one of his joints, and I was like, God damn, I got a long way to go. You know what I'm saying? And right now, dude fucking with the legendary Traxster, who is close friends with No ID, vice president of Def Jam, so he making moves quiet, but that's my, like, I listened to his shit for a long time, man.
Give him a plug. Shut him up.
Hey, E-Dub the Gangster, bro. Salute. He probably don't even know that I've been watching his shit for as long as I've been watching, but that's one of the, like, as far as, like, being real and saying exactly what you felt, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's how that dude spit. And I don't know. Y'all need to check that shit out. E-Dub Folks Nim Campbell or some shit like that. I think that's his name on Facebook, but dude is dope. He dubbed the gangster.
Okay, now when you first broke in and you started, who did you not like? Like, who pissed you off? And the fact that they were making moves and
the fact that they even existed,
right?
Probably. Well, at the time when I was coming up, it was a lot of people, but I would pay to hear those motherfuckers now over the bullshit that we have now. Because the bullshit that we have now and the bullshit that we had before is two totally different things. Like, I hated D4L. You know what I'm saying? And no knock to them and they hustle, but I hated that shit. Because when I was coming up, like, you know, you heard the Cloud9 show, that whole thing, that whole tape was done in Chicago while I was living this life. You know what I'm saying?
Quick plug, you want the Cloud 9 show, just hit us up and get you a copy.
True. And I got the first copy out in Charles City.
You know that.
Every
episode. I'm telling every motherfucker about it. Every time. That shit dope as hell, bro.
It is dope. Yeah. It's dope.
Keep but that up. Shit.
Charles City, I was the first one to have it, so.
That D4L, and I'm not even knocking their hustle because they did what they did. They got in the game, they made their money, and they got the fuck out the way. Yeah. But now these motherfuckers coming in with the bubblegum music and staying. Like, they sticking around, and they, like, oversaturating the business. So, that was it.
All right, who was some influences for you?
I hated Soulja Boy.
Who influenced you? Like, I know... Like, we got a lot of the same likes, so true. I already know, I think I know where you're going to go with this, but who were some influences for you? Like, who did you
like? Like, I listened to Pac, I listened to Biggie, I listened to Rakim, Wu-Tang, Daz Effects, that shit, you know, them boys is dope as shit, bro. Black Sheep, all them, like, but what made me grow my hair out, bro, Bone Thugs and Harmony, bro. No, listen. My guys, like I said this shit, I think in episode one, did I not? When we was at school, joint, like my mans and them used to literally go to the library and print out the lyrics to these songs. Listen, the first of the month came out, bro. Listen, I don't care if you from Chicago or from anywhere else. If you can't relate to first of the month, you ain't on shit.
That's that Midwest.
Because you came to, that's that Midwest joint. The first of the month. The 8th, the 15th, them shits. And the Grinders know what I'm talking about. 24/7 Grinders. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But them, on the Bone Thugs.
Boy, look.
And when really? I say you start sending your food stamps to get cash,
when I say like we relate on that, Bone Thugs and Harmony is what got me into rap. Like,
Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Around here, rap was not big. You had your country, you had your rock, but rap just was not a thing around here. And if you thought rap around here, people were fucking talking about Coolio. All
right. Right.
What happened?
Like one,
Coolio
two,
was dope, three. Though. He came out with the Gangsta Paradise.
What happened, happened in town to make them start liking rap? Go ahead.
Well, this white dude named Jay Fall started. Nah.
Big up Kaylin, Chad.
But real talk, like, rap was just not
and
a thing.
And he's white as fuck.
What's
right? Some hell.
No, Kayla.
Wait, y'all jumped off my shit though.
No,
bro.
Kayla was the rapper in the crew.
Bro. Yeah, I mean he was the blackest friend they had. But no, real shit. Bone Thugs and Harmony was my shit. Like Midwest alone. My hometown favorites of all time was Crucial Conflict. Look, Never, and you ain't heard a motherfucker chop it up like Never. And Wildstyle was a spitter, like this rapid fire. Bah, 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 bah. But Never was lyrical, and the way he can go forward and flip it and twist it again and twist it, do it that. But Bone Thugs and Harmony, that's what started me. Like, I literally grew hair, bro. Like, I had fucking long hair. I thought I was fucking Crazy Bone, bro. Or Flash, like, because Flash dope as hell. That's the fifth dog. You know what I'm talking about, you know what I mean? That dude, dope. Y'all get that shit, you know what I mean? Get up on that shit. This shit now, I don't too much listen to nobody, you know. All
right, well, now that you say that, now, who are you fucking with? Like, who you listen to now?
I bet you're going to say most of the names.
Hey, listen.
Main, what, like,
no,
popular underground or bro, just like...
No, let's
shit. The only shit I really listen to is Damn District Entertainment.
True.
No. And I listen to a couple of underground. I don't really listen to mainstream radio anymore.
I personally don't listen to mainstream anymore. I listen to underground, and a lot of the people that we end up on tour with or we do shows with, like, that's mm-hmm. who I'm bumping. Yeah. Black 300, Ruck Puff, you know,
mm-hmm.
I fucked with them a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
I'm in that thing. You hear me?
You hear me?
All right.
You hit me?
Who do you not like though? Like who pisses you off that you? If you hear a song, it's like, God damn, how the fuck are these guys?
Not answering that because I told you who I didn't like. You talking about underground now, right?
No. I want mainstream.
Like who, right now?
Yeah. Who's making money that pisses you off?
Touch this shit. Go ahead, get on it. This got a couple of
everybody I don't name, but you can weigh up what they sound like and what they do. You fucking be the judge for that. Because what I listen to, Beans, everybody from the Locks, the OSP, fucking State Property alone, Jigga, fucking Fifth. I still listen to Fifth old shit because when he first came out, he was definitely in I Get Money. Oh, my. You suckers. Y'all better listen. Everybody in Demi District. I don't even listen to my motherfucking self. That's the fucked up part. But I listen to everybody in Demi District but my motherfucking self. I don't listen to myself because I'm my worst critic. You feel me?
Yeah, me too.
I not told you, like, you be like, bro, this is a hit. I be like, bro, I don't like it. Mm-hmm. And he was like, fucking, don't you keep that in you? Keep that in you? Yeah. You're going to keep progressing. You feel me? And that's what I do. I said, X, the dog. Yeah, I'm the dog.
Who you don't X, like? Mike.
No, listen. You can just take from that right there and then decide from yourself. Because right. Listen to the platform of the music, each one of the artists I just named is totally different than everything that's going on right now today.
You fuck with Bobby Shmurda?
I don't even. Who is that?
See? I don't know.
Who is that?
Just fucked your bitch about a week ago.
We could go.
Alright. So, oh, I don't know. I want to put you guys on the spot. And I want you. You got to give me an artist right now. Who pisses you off when you hear them on the radio or you hear them, period? Right now. One artist. That they're making money.
Right now today, Young Thug. I don't give a fuck. Nigga scream at me.
Yeah, that's true.
No, fuck that. You ain't gonna talk about that. You ain't gonna talk about like that. You ain't giving back that mic shit.
Bro, not, listen to that shit.
I know, but.
You don't even say shit.
No, but he ain't. No. Okay,
you get me alone. Put him up.
No,
put him up, bro.
I'm like copping out, bro. That's the wackest motherfucking.
You gotta give a name that he ain't saying.
Chief Keef.
Alright, easy.
Hey, King
Louis. Well, shout out.
King Louis, Lil Herb, though, and my mama, they hold that city down, though. Them boys spit them shits, though. And I ain't dick riding either, but yeah, they, I fucks right. with. Hey, King Louis, Lil Herb, keep doing that thing, man.
Shout out E-Dub the Gangster, man.
And E-Dub the Gangster, too.
I'm gonna call him. Hey. I don't start no trouble, and I don't run away from none. That was my shit, bro.
And it sound good.
I'm like 18.
Anyway, let's show up.
We probably over.
We having fun.
We over time. But guess what?
We don't give a fuck. We're Diamond District Entertainment. We do what the fuck we want.
Give me my motherfucking shirt.
All right.
Shout out to Mariah.
Big up to my. All right. Besides Wiseworth family, Wiseworth.
I'm gonna give the shout out one more time.
Bob, everybody, bring your ass
back home, bro.
Bobby. Let's go, Wise. Come on, Bobby.
Come on, man. Let's get this shit going. All right, anything else y'all want to touch on? Like that's happened last week.
I want to touch on, man. I'm like really fucking pissed and really saddened that my sons both took injuries a day after each other.
Oh yeah, that's crazy.
Like it wasn't even 24 hours, and my youngest son, he took an injury to his knee, sprained his knee, and then my oldest son, starting quarterback, he sprained his thorn arm elbow, and I sat in the hospital on both. Like my Friday and Saturday was in the hospital. Like the doctors loved me there. We was jamming there. I don't know.
He was in the hospital.
Bro, I didn't even have to do that, bro. I'm sitting in the joint where they taking x-rays, and the bro was like, yo, you can step a hand here. And I'm standing there like, yeah, no, it don't look like a fracture. I felt like a motherfucking doctor. And then, like, I was pissed. Like, Junior, he gonna see this shit. I'm really mad at you because I stayed up in that joint until 1 o'clock on a goddamn Friday. Yeah.
You're upset about it.
I'm pissed. Okay. Friday.
We don't want to be pissed. We're not.
No, you know the shit I could have done on Friday.
Whoa.
Bring it back. Really? Sit it down now.
Let me fuck.
Woo! You want to go fishing?
No,
let me bring that back.
Let me tell you what, Crandaddy. That's
what he called it. That's what his friends call it.
Granddaddy.
That's gotta be the coolest thing in high school.
Hey, Granddaddy.
AKA Lil Mike.
Lil Michael.
He
don't even get
I was at Mike's crib earlier. He's like, my elbow hurt, but this motherfucker's like talking like this with the fucking sling. I'm like,
Yeah, he like, yo, like, you know, my elbow.
Yeah, what's your fuck?
Like, oh, my elbow hurt. Yo, don't go. Hey, no, he couldn't move his fingers in the hospital last night, right?
Right.
But this morning, he playing the game like this.
Oh, I was over at the crib.
I called the motherfucker like... I caught him on his Apple book and shit. He over there typing. Like, I said, bitch, your fingers work, man.
I was over there, dude. I seen that
fucking
shit.
Fucking asshole.
You're a fucking faker, man.
Yeah, you are.
You and Peanut, bro.
Hey, leave Peanut out of this. He's got a legit...
Hey, now, fuck that. Peanut got the doctor's thinking he's got a broken arm in 2 spots. That fucking faker.
True.
All right, no, I'm going to reel it back a little bit.
Yeah, let's do it.
But before I do that, there's one person I do want to shout out that we fuck with in Kansas City. We fuck with a couple times before.
Katy Perry live in Kansas City?
No, but if she did, I'd be there. Mad Marlin.
Man, not the Martian.
Mad Marlin.
Yeah, no shit.
That Martian, I thought we shot him out already.
No, we didn't even talk about his performance. His performance is crazy.
Mad
Marlin.
No, keep doing
it. Hey, my shit is he repped the middle of the map. That's my shit.
And he
grinds. You can say this. You can say that.
You grind harder than anybody that we probably fuck with.
Yeah, he's like the grinding, bro.
Like, yeah, like,
that's
real tight, dude. I just wanted to shout you out quick, Mad Marlin, because you do your thing, bro. We fucks with you. But on some real shit, November is a big month for us. We got a lot of stuff going on. For people who don't know, Diamond District is very big into charity. Even though we don't have a lot ourselves, we love to give back. We are Booster Club members in Charles City. Little League sponsors. Mm-hmm. We do whatever we
bowling
can.
Bowling teams and all that.
Sponsor and coach.
Whatever we can do, we try to give back to our community 100. Like,
this is water.
Whatever we can do. If we, you know what? If we can give anything, we'll do it.
It's water.
But... with that said, you know, Thanksgiving is huge for a lot of people. A lot of people can't celebrate it the way they would like to. So we're going to do our best to make sure that those people can have the Thanksgiving that they deserve. Because they're out there working 60 hours a week just to pay the bills. We know what that's like. We do the same shit. So what we're going to do... we're going to throw a free show, which we haven't done in quite a while.
So look for that.
And we got a date in mind. I'm going to give the date. Now, this is very tentative.
You going to give it a date?
Huh?
You going to give
it? Yeah, I'm going to give a date. I'm going to give a date. November 22nd, which is the Saturday before Thanksgiving, we're going to do a show. On top of that, we're going to do something else. We're not quite sure what it's going to be, whether it's a turkey dinner. We're going to try to give out turkeys. Whatever it is, we're going to do something big that Saturday. We're going to be very, very full that Saturday.
And mind you, we not working with a lot of money ourselves.
True.
But we are blessed to that we wake up with our own families and we can't eat together with our own families. And we just trying to get back. We're not trying to do nothing bigger than the next person. We just taking this out of our own time because we've been blessed.
Very
to
nice.
Do what we have to do. Everybody that I know works. Everybody here works. If I don't care if you wiping asses to cutting hairs, you wiping down cars to passing out uniforms, if you teaching kids, however, everybody work. And but we are blessed to eat with our families all through the year. And I don't have a problem. And this team don't have a problem. This family don't have a problem with making sure that your family eat too. If we can do at least one time a year.
All right, and we're going to do
that. Everybody eat.
Stay tuned for those details. We're going to do what we can for everybody in this community. We love Charles City. This is our home. So we're going to do whatever we can for y'all. Now, with that said, we only got a few seconds left. Next week, we want you to tune in. We're going to have Midwest Dub. We're going to have Midwest Dub on the set. He's going to be releasing a new song. So stay tuned. Next week, we'll see y'all. Check it out.
I love everybody that loves me.